What is going on, everybody? It is Bronco Juggalo, and it is again Slashback Saturday. Today, I am doing See No Evil Part 2. Yes, I know I haven't done See No Evil Part 1 yet, and there is a reason for that. The reason is I was going to do a completely different movie for Slashback Saturday. I was going to do a movie that on the back of the case, it said that it was about a demented doctor. So, as you know, today's category is medical slashers. So I thought, hey, that fits right in. Well, I've watched the movie, and I realized it was not a slasher at all. More like a House of a Thousand Corpses kind of movie, which I will be doing a review for that later. That is a Wild Eye movie called Bloody Scum, and I did enjoy it, so I've been doing a review for that as well. But it is Slashback Saturday, and I needed a medical slasher to do for Slashback Saturday. What can I do? I've already done Dr. Giggles, Halloween 2. I don't have a copy of The Dentist, or I can't find it to stream. There's so many other medical slashers that I just don't have access to at this moment because it's very late in the game. I expected to have this done earlier in the week. I didn't get a chance to do it. And then I watched the movie and I realized I just wasted some time watching the movie. So then I had to watch this other movie. But whatever. We're here and we're doing See No Evil 2. I will do the original eventually. I promise. See No Evil 2 takes up right after See No Evil 1. For those of you that have not seen See No Evil 1, here's some minor spoilers. A character named Jacob Goodnight, a really big giant slasher motherfucker, played by Kane, WWE's Glenn Kane Jacobs, plays Jacob Goodnight in the first movie. He is living in an abandoned hotel. Some people go in to fix up the hotel and he kills them all. That's the basic plot of the first movie. Now then, all of those people, including Kane, who is now dead, are being transported to a local hospital, City Morgue. They get there, and Amy, who is supposed to be getting off work to go celebrate her birthday, played by Danielle Harris, she decides, you know what, you guys have all these people coming in, all these bodies coming in, I'm going to stick around and help, forget my birthday. She calls her friends, sorry guys, can't make it. Her friends are like, oh, that sucks. Her boss is there. Her boss decides to be a really cool guy. He calls all of her friends, brings them to the city hospital, to the county hospital, whatever the fuck, down to the morgue, and they have a birthday party right there for her in the morgue. Glenn Jacobs, who is dead, well, guess what? He wakes up and he starts killing everybody in that fucking morgue. So there you have it. That's why I'm doing this movie. That's the plot of the movie. This is what we're doing today, guys. I like this movie a lot. I really like the first one, and I really like the second one. Now, some people may say, oh, Kane, I mean, he's not really an actor. You know what? He's got enough acting experience in my book, and he does a really good job as Jacob Goodnight. In fact, he's my first pro, but I'll get into that here in a minute. One of the cool things I found out about this movie is that Danielle Harris, along with two of the other actresses, performed all their own stunts. And I thought that was really cool. Kane performed his own stunts. I mean, why wouldn't he? He does this for a living. He's a professional wrestler. He knows how to take hits. He knows what to do. But it is really amazing that all the girls performed their own stunts. That was really cool. And to think Danielle Harris performed all her own stunts really isn't too big of a stretch. Because if you think back all the way to Halloween 4 and 5, the stunt on the roof, she did that. The stunt in the laundry chute, she did that. The stunt running in front of the car, she did that. All those things she did. I've said a lot of times that I always picture Danielle Harris as the young girl that she is in part 4 and 5 of Halloween, because that's what I picture her as. That's what I watch all the time. Even now, even though knowing she's grown up, she's my age. Danielle Harris is my age. And I still think of her as that little girl. This movie, I was able to take myself out of that and picture her just as a young woman as she is. And it was a lot of fun. I think that this movie is really good. It shows what a good, straight-up slasher can still do. And that's what this movie is. It's a straight-up slasher movie. It doesn't have any, you know, deeper storyline or anything like that. No hidden meanings. It's just a straight-up slasher movie. But it's a lot of fun. It's a good, well-written slasher movie. I guess I forgot to mention the directors at the beginning of this because I was so getting into everything. This was directed by Jen and Sylvia Soska, who actually, in the very beginning of this film, both of the directors play dead bodies in the movie. And I think that's really cool. So we're going to start with cons because I really don't have many. In fact, I only have two, but we're just going to roll it into one. Because all my cons have to basically do with the characters in the movie. And it is the secondary characters that I'm speaking of. We have some very stereotypical slasher secondary characters, which I don't mind, but I think they could have just fleshed them out a little bit more, made them a little bit more interesting. We have your douchebag, who also happens to be the brother. We have the whore. We have the geeks. And this one, there's actually two of them. We have all the different stereotypes for slasher movies in this movie. And I just really don't like that. Specifically, I don't like the brother character. He's just a douche, and I don't like him. But what I really don't like is he's talking to the whore character. I'm sorry, I'm not trying to be mean. But come on, that's what she is portraying. And I'm not saying that the character is actually a whore, but that's the stereotype role she's filling. They're talking, and she's like, "Why don't you like me like I like you?" And he's like, "I think of you as my sister." And then 2 seconds later, they're like, all up in each other. Yeah, okay, I don't want to be a part of that family. But that's it for my cons, guys. That really is. Just those two small things. I don't like the brother at all. And the characters are all stereotypical. The secondary characters. That's the only things I don't like about this movie. And it's not even that I don't like it. I don't mind it, really. They're just minor cons. They're really nitpicky cons at this point. As I said, I want to start out my pros with Glenn Kane Jacobs. I think the man does an amazing job for only having done one feature film before this. His acting experience. He does have some acting experience in WWE, cutting promos, things like that. He's been playing a character for his entire career, the character of Kane, so it's not too big of a stretch for him. But I just think he does a really good job. He portrays that tormented soul so well that he is in this movie. And I really like that. Also, he portrays a great psychopath. I love his resurrection or wake-up scene. He resurrects or wakes up while a couple is having sex in the room that he's on the cold slab in. In fact, the girl just happened to was straddling him a little while ago. She's all into serial killers and dead bodies and shit. And she was trying to make out with him. I mean, she does kiss him. He's dead. I think it wouldn't put her past her to be into some necrophilia. But that's just my opinion. Because it obviously got her very turned on. I'm going to couple these together. I love the kills. I think the kills are really good. They're really well-rounded. There's some interesting stuff that's being done because there's a lot of medical equipment around. I like how Jacob Goodnight uses his signature weapon from the first movie. But it's all sterile looking and clean because it came out of the morgue, out of the hospital. And it's the hook on the chain. I really enjoyed that. The directors wanted Jacob Goodnight to become one of the icons of horror. They wanted him to be the next Freddy or Michael. And I can see that. I wish they would do another movie because I do think he may not reach those heights, but he could be up in there with the secondary characters like Victor Crowley, Ghostface, Leprechaun, you know, the secondary level of the horror echelon, if you know what I'm saying. I love the atmosphere of this movie. My favorite setting for a horror movie is an asylum. Well, hospitals run a really close second. I like hospitals. I like this, the morgue setting. It is very, very creepy, very atmospheric, and it just lends a great tone to this film. I really love Jacob's death. Spoiler here, guys. One of our main characters, Seth, who is Amy's love interest in the film, Daniel Harris's love interest, he takes a hose that's attached to the formaldehyde pumper, whatever, you know, reservoir, sticks it into him and just pumps him full of formaldehyde. His eye pops out, blood shoots out his eye, and then the formaldehyde pops out. You can see all the blue formaldehyde going through his veins. It's seeping out his pores. It's coming out of everywhere. I love that. I think that's a really, really cool death scene. Death scene. Oh, my next pro is that I love how this movie throws a twist at you. Not like a Saw type of twist, or an M. Night Shyamalan twist. But you go throughout this whole film thinking, okay, Danielle Harris, Amy's character, will be the final girl. She will be the last one standing. Nope, she got killed. Seth was the last man standing. Or was he? Guys, if you have not seen See No Evil 2, go ahead and check it out. But check out number one first. And like I said, I will get to part one review. I'll probably try and do it within the next couple weeks. The only reason I did it out of order was because of the Slashback Saturday. And I needed a medical movie to do a medical horror, medical slasher. And I was running out of time and running out of options for this week. So I hope you guys bear with me. I'm sorry I'm doing it ass backwards. But that's just the way I'm doing it right now. Anyways, guys, this is Bronco Juggalo saying, go check out everybody else doing Slashback Saturday. Big ups to Joe the Horror Man for creating Slashback Saturday. You're awesome, bro. Much love. Peace.
Talking about mob shit. Couple hundred grand, I ain't much.
Mob shit.
One phone call, you can get.